Welcome to our service tonight at the Tron. It's good to see you, and if you're visiting with us, you're particularly welcome. Do stay behind afterwards. There'll be coffee and tea here, out there somewhere, and generally around the place, and an opportunity to hang around, to meet and chat to one another and encourage one another in the Lord. We're going to begin by singing. We're looking this evening again at Isaiah. One of Isaiah's great words for the Lord is that he calls him the Lord of hosts, the Lord of the hosts of heavens, who is a wonder in his counsel and excellent in wisdom. And we're going to begin by singing number 248, immortal, invisible, God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes, most holy, most glorious, the ancient of days, almighty, victorious, your great name we praise. Number 248. Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Let's pray. Lord, that is our desire, the desire of our hearts and our purpose as we come before you this evening, as we join together in the name of Jesus, your Son, that we should, in turning our minds to the Christ in the story, the great story of your salvation, that he would remain not only as a story to us, but that the knowledge of him and his love for us and his greatness, his power, his glory, his call upon our lives, that that would come home to our hearts, that we would be a people not of understanding only in our intellect, but those who have been mastered by you, touched by your gospel of grace, changed, brought to our knees, and lifted up again to be your people, filled with rejoicing, brought to new life, new purpose, and new joy in our Lord Jesus Christ. Never, Lord, let this remain outside of us, we pray. Never let it be merely a matter of learning. That learning that reaches the innermost parts of our being. And we thank you, Lord, that such is your living word to us, that these are not just words written on a page in front of us that we'll be studying in this Bible tonight, but that this is the word of life, breathed out by your own Spirit, preserved by that same Spirit, and taught to us in the power of the Spirit, that our hearts might be opened by your Spirit to hear with clarity, to take in with deep understanding your very words for our lives this night. We thank you, Lord, that we can come with such confidence into your presence, to the Lord of hosts, the one who is wonderful in counsel, excellent in wisdom, and ready, willing, who delights to share that wisdom with us, to lavish upon us the truths of your everlasting gospel. So, Lord, as we come before you tonight, strip away from us, we pray, all distraction, all confusion, all darkness, all muddle, and lay us open, we pray, to your word, to your presence, personally speaking into our hearts and into our lives. And may we go from this place, we ask, Lord, filled with fresh vigor in your service, fresh delight in your goodness, with a greater desire to love and to serve you, and to love and serve one another together, that we might together be the people that you've called us to be in this place, in this city, throughout all that we do this coming week, in our homes, in our workplaces, places of study, with our friends, with all with whom we encounter. We are your people, called by your name, and we long for your name to be glorified and exalted in this city and in this nation. So come to us, Lord, we pray. Stir us up to love and good deeds, and may we go on stirring up one another to the same love and good deeds in the name of Jesus Christ. Put a song in our heart, we pray, and a purpose in our lives, that we may begin to be the people you've called us to be, and that we shall be forever and ever in your service, in your everlasting kingdom. So hear us, Lord, in this our evening prayer. Help us, for by nature our hearts are dull and cold. Wake us up and fill us with your Holy Spirit, we ask. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen. Just one or two notices to remind you of this evening. If you have one of these yellow sheets, if you're here this morning, you will have had one. If not, and they're not out tonight, then pick one up on the trolleys outside on your way out, if you would. A number of things, just two things to remind you of. We're having a special evening on Tuesday evening, cleaning the building here. The more of us that are able to be here to help out, the easier it will be and the quicker it will be, and fun and fellowship will be had by all. So let me encourage you to come and join us from 7 o'clock on Tuesday evening. All will be provided, and all you need is your own elbow grease. We'll be very glad if you can do that. then also just to say again, as we said this morning, that it's a great encouragement to us, and we hope a great encouragement to all in the Ministry of Hope for Glasgow, especially Terry McCutcheon, that our Christmas offering raised just shy of £32,000 for the work. And let's join those givings with our prayers that all that we've given and more besides would be used by that ministry for the glory of God among many of the needy folk, neediest folk perhaps in our city here. So let's give thanks to God. Well done. And let's pray that God will use that greatly for his glory. Well, we're going to sing again, and I'm going to hand over to Bob, who's going to come and bring God's word to us. Number 732, Lord, be my vision, supreme in my heart, bid every rival give way and depart. Number 732.
Now we come to our reading this evening, which I think you heard that first bit very clearly, probably too clearly, which is once again in the book of Isaiah. And if you turn please to page 588, and we'll be looking at chapter 28. Just a quick word about the place of this in the book. We've been doing an occasional series on Isaiah over the last few months. Now, I've tried to divide this gigantic book into sections, and we're coming to the third section this evening, which is really chapters 28 to 39. One of the most striking things about Isaiah is how he, From his vantage point in Jerusalem, he looks out over the whole world, indeed the whole created order. He's continually moving between these two points, if you like, from his own hometown, so to speak, then looking out widely. And in the previous chapters, chapters 13 to 27, the oracles against the nations, he's swept around the nations of the time, and indeed in the chapters we looked at the last 2 weeks, chapters 24 to 27, he's given us visions of the new creation, of the whole created order redeemed. But now he's returning to his own hometown, if you like, and to the nations of Judah and Israel. Remember, Isaiah is a poet. The language is vivid, and therefore we must try and respond to it in that way. So Isaiah 28, and we'll read the chapter, page 588. The proud crown of the drunkards of Ephraim, and the fading flower of its glorious beauty, which is on the head of the rich valley of those overcome with wine. Behold, the Lord has one who is mighty and strong, like a storm of hail, a destroying tempest, like a storm of mighty overflowing waters. He casts down to the earth with his hand. The proud crown of the drunkards of Ephraim will be trodden underfoot, and the fading flower of its glorious beauty, which is on the head of the rich valley, will be like a first ripe fig before the summer. When someone sees it, he swallows it as soon as it is in his hand. In that day, the Lord of hosts will be a crown of glory and a diadem of beauty to the remnant of his people, and a spirit of justice to him who sits in judgment, and strength to those who turn back the battle at the gate. He's also reel with wine and stagger with strong drink. The priest and the prophet reel with strong drink. They are swallowed by wine. They stagger with strong drink. They reel in vision. They stumble in giving judgment. For all tables are full of filthy vomit, with no space left. Who will he teach knowledge? And to whom will he explain the message? Those who are weaned from the milk, those taken upon breast, for it is precept upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little. For by people of strange lips and with a foreign tongue, the Lord will speak to this people, to whom he has said, this is rest, give rest to the weary, and this is repose. Yet they would not hear. And the word of the Lord will be to them precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little, that they may go and fall backward and be broken and snared and taken. Therefore, hear the word of the Lord, you scoffers who rule this people in Jerusalem, because you have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with Sheol we have an agreement. When the overwhelming whip passes through, it will not come to us, for we made lies our refuge, and in falsehood we have taken shelter. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am the one who has laid as a foundation in Zion a stone, a tested stone, a precious cornerstone of a sure foundation. Whoever believes will not be in haste, and I will make justice the line, and righteousness the plumb line, and hail will sweep away the refuge of lies, and waters will overwhelm the shelter. Then your covenant with death will be annulled, and your agreement with Sheol will not stand when the overwhelming scourge passes through. You will be beaten down by it. As often as it passes through, it will take you, for morning by morning it will pass through, by day and by night. And it will be sheer terror to understand the message, for the bed is too short to stretch oneself on, and the covering too narrow to wrap oneself in. For the Lord will rise up as on Mount Perazim, as in the valley of Gibeon he will be roused, to do his deed. Strange is his deed, and to work his work. Alien is his work. Now therefore, do not scoff, lest your bonds be made strong. For I heard a decree of destruction from the Lord God of hosts against the whole land. give ear and hear my voice. Give attention and hear my speech. Does he who ploughs for sowing plough continually? Does he continually open and harrow his ground when he has levelled its surface? Does he not scatter dill, sow cumin, and put in wheat in rows, and barley in its proper place, and emmer as the border? For he is rightly instructed, his God teaches him. Dill is not threshed with a threshing sledge, nor is a cartwheel rolled over cumin, but dill is beaten out with a stick, and cumin with a rod. Does one crush grain for bread? No, he does not thresh it forever. When he drives his cartwheel over it with his horses, he does not crush it. This also comes from the Lord of hosts. He is wonderful in counsel and excellent in wisdom. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. And that passage says so much about true and false vision. And we're going to sing a hymn that comes to us from one of the great early figures of the church, Augustine, great early theologian and pastor, 737, O matchless beauty of our God, so ancient and so new, kindle in us your fire of love, fall on us as the dew. Number 737.
Thank you.
Now, as the musicians play, we're going to take up the offering. Let's pray. The Apostle John wrote, "This is the message we have heard from him, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his Son cleanses us from all sin." Now we thank you, Father, for these words, both of challenge and encouragement. We have sung that so often we are tempted by lesser beauties, so often we stray far from home. And we thank you for the Master's voice that calls his sheep and will not let any of them go. And as we lay these gifts before you, Father, we pray indeed that you will bless them to the building up of your kingdom here and elsewhere. As we pray this, we thank you for all who work and labor in the vineyard, in the gospel, and for all who bring this message of light into the darkness. Father, we pray that the light of the gospel may indeed shine into the dark places of the world and into the dark places of our hearts. And indeed, we pray for us all. We pray that we will speak wisely, that we will be channels of your grace, that by our living and by our speaking, we may be good servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. Almighty and everlasting God, who forgives the sins of all who truly repent, create in us new and humble hearts, that we may receive from you forgiveness and assurance through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Before we look at Isaiah 28, we're going to sing number 832. "We have not known you as we ought, nor learned your wisdom, grace, and power. The things of earth have filled our thought, mere shadows of the passing hour."
Thank you.
Now, could we have our Bibles open, please, at Isaiah 28 on page 588, and we'll have a moment of prayer. God, our Father, we believe you have things to say to us, things that we need to hear, things that will often challenge our preconceptions, light that will shine into our darkness. And we pray, Lord, that your gracious Holy Spirit, who inspired these words long ago, may bring them to us not as echoes of a distant and vanished era, but as the very living words that you are speaking to us now. And we ask this in the name of the living Word, the Lord Christ himself, in whose name we pray. Amen. The poet T.S. Eliot once said, "Humankind cannot bear very much reality." And that's absolutely true. And that's just as true of Christian humankind as it is of other humankind. We do love so often to live in a fantasy land. We do often love to live in a land which is what we would like it to be, rather than what it is. And the prophet here is determined that the people he is speaking to, and that's us as well, of course, not just the people of the time, that our eyes will be opened to reality. That's our title for tonight, Opening Eyes to Reality, Living in the Real World, and not least the reality about ourselves. As you know, we tend to swing between thinking we're really rather good people, then going to the opposite extreme and thinking there's absolutely nothing commendable about us at all. Well, the prophet is saying, open your eyes, or as the Apostle John says, walk in the light as he is in the light. Now, just two things I want to say by way of introduction. These passages, this chapter and 29 and the following chapters, are rather bleak. Now, if you were here the last few weeks or perhaps earlier on in the series, when we looked at some of these glowing pictures of the new creation, those pictures of the wolf lying down with the lamb, little child playing at the serpent's den, and these wonderful visions of the nations crowding to Mount Zion to be blessed by the Lord. And you might well feel, well, he's getting back to the real world. Now, that's simply not true. Both these worlds are real. But it's quite a contrast, though, isn't it? Such a contrast it is that many commentators can't handle it and say it must have been written by different people. Isaiah, who wrote about the desert blossoming as the rose and so on, couldn't have written this. You know, some commentators are such Philistines. They have absolutely no literary sensitivity at all. They don't see that the prophet is actually living in the real world, and he is anticipating an even more real world that already exists and is to come. You see, the only way we can effectively live in this world is by being transformed by the renewing of our minds as we wait for the coming of the kingdom. There is contrast, but there is no contradiction. Both things are true. We live in this world which is perplexed, confusing, often vicious, often nasty, and we are preparing for that world to come. And that was the prayer at the end of our last hymn, Lord, may we day by day prepare to see your face and serve you there. And a word about the time of the prophecies. Back in chapter 1, verse 1, Isaiah tells us he prophesied during the reigns of four kings, probably for a period of 40 and more years, perhaps as much as 50 years. Jotham, one of the yes-but kings, who was quite good, but ultimately made little impact. Then, of course, King Uzziah, in whose year of whose death he had the great vision of Yahweh of hosts, holy, 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 as Yahweh of hosts, a man who began well but ended tragically. But much of his prophecy centers around the reign of the two next kings, King Ahaz a godless king who took the nation back to idolatry, and whom Isaiah said to in chapter 7, if you do not stand firm in faith, you will not stand firm at all. Ahaz, live in the real world. You're not going to save the nation by cozying up to the Assyrians. If you do not stand firm in faith, you will not stand firm at all. Now, these prophecies, 28 to 39, probably come from the reign of Ahaz's son, an utterly different kind of man, Hezekiah. We read in 2 Kings that Hezekiah was a man of faith. There was no one like him before and no one like him after. Oh, he wobbled a bit. He flirted with Egypt and with Babylon, but ultimately the assessment of the biblical prophet is he was a man of faith. And it's very likely that these prophecies come from the very early years of his reign, before his great reforms had begun to make an impact. After all, you don't turn aside 20-odd years of godlessness in a day or two. So that's the kind of situation. Hezekiah has come to the throne, but there are still many, many people, particularly in the leadership, who prefer the old ways of Ahaz, the ways of diplomacy and politicking, rather than trusting in the Lord. So that's the background. And just one other point. Ephraim, mentioned here in the first verses, is the name given to the northern kingdom, which is about to fall. So that's the situation then. Let's look at the chapter now as it develops in three major sections. First of all, verses 1 to 13, pride and a fall. This is pride which is coming before a fall. Pride and a fall. Ephraim is, as I say, the name of the northern kingdom. Just quickly to remind you, after the reign of Solomon, the kingdom was torn apart, and part of the 10 of the tribes, 10 of the tribes in the north, and 2 of the tribes, Judah and Benjamin, in the south. And sometimes the northern tribes are called Ephraim, because Ephraim and Manasseh were the sons of Joseph. And you get this in some of the Psalms that talk about Joseph as the representative of the north. Now, Ephraim was about to fall to Assyria. But in spite of lurching from one crisis to another, in spite of being totally ineffective, it is still absolutely filled with pride. Back in 1 Kings 16, Omri, father of the better-known King Ahab, built the strong city of Samaria on a beautiful hill. That's what's referred to here. The fading flower of his glorious beauty, which is on the head of the rich valley, in verse 1, in verse 4. Beautiful, strong city, so strong indeed that the Assyrian war machine took 3 years to overthrow it. This strong city on its beautiful hill. And earlier on, the prophet Amos had attacked the indulgence and arrogance of its citizens. A place of great luxury, a place of great oppression, and a place where the rich were getting richer and the poor were getting poorer. The rich in their ivory houses, Amos talks about, and the poor are trodden underfoot. Now, what this has got to do with us? You might think, oh, well, fair enough, that's then, what about now? Now, this can all seem remote, or it can be turned into a rant on an indulgent lifestyle. One way of preaching this would be simply to give a rant about drink and about self-indulgence and so on. But that's not really what the passage is about. The self-indulgence, the drunkenness, is the symptom of something else, far deeper. It is the symptom of pride, the proud crown. Verse 1, verse 3, the proud crown. And pride, remember, is the natural human condition without the grace of God. Pride is a daily temptation that we all struggle with. And there are two aspects of pride which are just as relevant to us as they were to the inhabitants of Samaria, which are clearly shown here. First of all, pride means boundless confidence in ourselves. strong, beautiful, the glorious beauty, the head of the rich valley, and so on. That is the first element of pride. And verse 7, the real in vision. In other words, they're not seeing reality. Cocooned by their luxury, cocooned by their apparent power, they're not seeing clearly. Does that only happen in the world? Of course not. Remember Revelation 3, the church in Laodicea. I am rich. I have prospered. I need nothing. Undoubtedly, that's what Laodicea's website would say. Laodicea's website would not say, we are poor, miserable, and naked and blind, as the Lord said about them. It's so easy, isn't it, to be proud. Proud of our gifts, proud of our churches. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. How easy it is to sing these words, isn't it? How hard to carry them out. It's always tempting to trust in our gifts rather than in the Lord himself. I'm sure you notice verse 8, this disgusting verse. All tables are full of filthy vomit with no space left. Suppose you told somebody that's in the Bible, they might not well believe you. Why is that there? What is the point? The point surely is ultimately pride is ugly and ridiculous. Human beings strutting and fretting their hour upon the stage, dressed in a little brief authority. There is something ridiculous, something ugly about human pride. Something that is a total denial of the gospel. Ephraim, only a few years before it was to be trodden into the dust. Verse 2, behold the Lord as one who is mighty and strong, like a storm of hail, a destroying tempest. Notice it doesn't say here Assyria is going to come and conquer you. Rather, the Lord has one who is mighty and strong. Isaiah said this already back in chapter 10, that the Assyrian is the rod of his anger. He'll use Assyria to punish his own people, and then he'll punish Assyria. That's the point. Strutting and fretting, drawing attention to ourselves. That's the first aspect of pride. But the second aspect that comes out very clearly in this section is boundless contempt for those thought to be inferior. And that's probably the point of verses 9 and 10. To whom will he teach knowledge? I think that's probably a dig at the prophet himself. Ephraim in its drunken pride does not want to hear the message of the prophet. A simple and naive preacher who comes telling them they need to repent, comes telling them they need to change. As Isaiah say, well, if you won't listen to this teaching, you're going to have to listen to it. Verse 11, by people of strange lips and with a foreign tongue, the Lord will speak to this people. If you won't listen to it from me, you'll hear it from the Assyrians, and you'll have to listen then. People of strange lips with a foreign tongue, the Assyrian language, fairly like Hebrew, but not enough alike for people to understand it. You see, this message is, look at verse 12. This is rest. Give rest to the weary, and this is repose, yet they would not hear. If they had listened to the voice of the prophet, they would have been saved. If they had listened to the voice of the prophet, this disaster would not have happened. And try and if you can't learn this way, you're going to learn the hard way. Now, once again, what's this got to do with us? You know, the devil is a very, very subtle enemy. If he can't stop us reading our Bibles, if he can't stop us listening to preaching, he's going to try and do his best to pervert that, isn't he? And what's going to happen is we're going to start admiring gurus and not listening to what they say. We're going to start admiring the preacher rather than the preaching. We're going to, what Paul says, we're going, I of Paul, I of Apollos, I of Cephas. and the super-spiritual eye of Christ. Now, the point is, it's not wrong to admire preachers. There are certain preachers I admire greatly and will learn, no doubt, a great deal from. But that's not the point. The point is, the Bible always, it's not the prophet, it's the prophesying. It's not the preacher, it's the preaching. That is the point. And of course, it's terribly easy to think, oh, we're so clever, we need really deep teaching. And kind of think, oh, isn't that such a clever guy? I can't understand a word he says. Well, if that's the case, that is a condemnation. If you can't understand a word he says, then he hasn't bothered to make himself clear. C.S. Lewis once said, if we cannot express our faith clearly, we either don't understand it or we don't believe it. And that's quite thought-provoking. Some we can be muddled, or on the other hand, an awful lot of the muddle comes because people don't really believe what they're saying. And therefore it comes across as confused. And that is the gospel, of course, is profound. The Bible will never be exhausted. But the task of the prophet, the task of the preacher, is indeed precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little, there a little. A theologian of an earlier date, James Denny, who was once principal of Glasgow University, said, "No preacher can prove himself to be clever and prove that Jesus Christ is a great saviour." Now, of course, for Isaiah, it must have been a great time. I mean, after all, Isaiah is an artist in words. He's a poet. His language is tremendous. So you see the point here. Pride, boundless confidence in ourselves, and boundless contempt for those considered inferior. Not the gospel is naive, not that the gospel is simplistic, but there's a basic simplicity. Verse 12 again. This is rest. Give rest to the weary. Yet they would not hear. And because they wouldn't hear, they were going to have to hear. Now, that's Ephraim, the northern kingdom. And now he turns, of course, to his own kingdom of Judah. Therefore, hear the word of the Lord, you scoffers who rule this people in Jerusalem. Israel, Ephraim is doomed. Can Judah be saved? Now, looks as a false security. We have made a covenant with death, and with Sheol we have an agreement. Undoubtedly, these were not the words that they actually used in public. They weren't going around saying, oh, we've made a covenant with death and with the grave. What they were actually saying is that we are safe ourselves. We did ignore the covenant. This morning, Willie was speaking about the covenant that Lord made with Moses, which remains the standard for all future generations. Now, you say, well, we don't need that covenant. We've made a covenant with death and hell. As I say, these are probably the early days of Ahaz. Ahaz had made a treaty with the king of Assyria. We're not going to be in any problems with Assyria. Our king... Actually made sure that we wouldn't be. One of the things that the king's historian praises Hezekiah for is he rebelled against the king of Assyria and would not serve him. So you see, there's a fatal choice here, choosing death rather than life. Scoffers, these are probably, say, the vestiges of Ahaz's old guard, who were still preaching politics, still saying, we're in no danger. They won't come here. Verse 18, then your covenant with death will be annulled, and your agreement with Sheol will not stand. When the overwhelming scourge passes through, you'll be beaten down by it. And it will come and keep on coming. It passes through, verse 19, morning by morning, by day and by night. And actually, is the point of this curious, this rather odd-sounding verse, verse 20. The bed is too short to stretch oneself on, the covering too narrow to wrap oneself in. That is the equivalent of our phrase, you've made your bed, so you've got to lie in it. They're making their bed. And the tragedy is their bed is the grave. Their bed is death and the end. So, living in the real world. But even here, there is a note of hope. I want to mention verses 5 and 6, which you thought I had forgotten about, and then, of course, verses 16 and 17. The Lord's purpose will stand, however much his people fail, however blind his people are, will stand. In that day, the Lord of hosts will be a crown of glory, a diadem of beauty. You don't need to pretend that you are so special. The point is, the Lord himself, he makes you special. Clothed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before his throne. Don't go parading before the throne of God and posturing with your own clothes on, because they are, Jeremiah used to say, they're filthy rags. The point is, God has provided garments of salvation. And then again, in verse 16, behold, I am the one who was laid as a foundation in Zion, a stone, a tested stone. Peter quotes these words in his first letter and applies them to Christ, of course. But you see, taking the big picture, after many, many years of unsatisfactory and downright bad rule, David had come to the throne again. That's what King says. Hezekiah walked in all the ways of David, his father. And there was no one like him before or after. So you see, even at that time, the fact that the good King Hezekiah has come to the throne is security. And the reason for that is not because Hezekiah is the Messiah. Although perhaps some people, although the assessment was so positive, perhaps some people even fleetingly hoped that might be. He was a failure, of course, but in his failure, in his flaws, he was still faithful. And he pointed to Christ himself, the Son of David, who would one day establish Zion, who would one day be a spirit of justice and who sits in judgment and strength to those who turn back the battle at the gate. So you see, we've got the pride before a fall. We've got the danger of the fatal choice, the wrong covenant. And finally, in verses 23 to 29, we have the way of true wisdom. Isaiah never leaves people simply saying, well, what do we do about it? Isaiah says, look, it's still not too late to follow the way of true wisdom. The style here is very different. This could fit comfortably into the book of Proverbs. Remember, Isaiah is a wisdom teacher as well as a prophet. He adopts the style of wisdom. And basically, Isaiah is saying, the way of wisdom is to follow the way the Creator governs his universe. Meaning, what's the only lesson about farmers and sowing seed and so on, and dill and cumin and all the rest of it? The point is, Isaiah is saying, God has built certain principles into the universe, and it's the way of wisdom to follow them. And that's the very heart of the book of Proverbs. The fear of Yahweh is the beginning of wisdom. There are two things here. The Lord reveals himself in the created order. That's the point of these verses. The rhythms of sowing, ploughing, and reaping. That's, remember, Israel is essentially an agricultural nation whose life and whose yearly routines depended on these. And you see, you can imagine the scoffer saying, oh, this simplistic stuff again. Why'd we hear about farmers and ploughmen and so on? The point is, Isaiah is saying, these people you despise are actually following the wisdom of the Creator. Because verse 26, he is rightly instructed because God teaches him. Sow at the right time so that you can reap at the right time. Don't spend all the time sowing. Don't spend all the time reaping. Don't use the wrong kind of tools. Don't use the wrong sort of methods. You see, this makes sense. It may be simple, but it makes sense. But behind this, there is something else. Because we've read about the covenant with death and hell, which, of course, sets aside and rejects the covenant with Moses. But we're going back to a yet earlier covenant, God's covenant with creation after the flood, the covenant that God made with Noah. As long as the earth remains, so summer and winter, sowing and reaping, day and night will never cease. That seems to be the point. God is faithful. God is committed to his creation because one day he's going to make it new. God hasn't written off his creation. God will judge and God will save. So that's the first thing. The Lord reveals himself in the created order. Those of Isaiah saying, if you won't listen to my words, go out into the fields and look. Ask yourself sensible questions. And the final point, which seems to me to be the ultimate point Isaiah is making, verse 29, the Lord is wiser than us. Now, that may seem an obvious thing to say, but I'm not sure we actually live our lives that way. We do so often tend to think that we know better than the Lord. This is harking back to the wonderful counselor of chapter 9. Remember the great verse about the one who is to come, one of whose titles is Wonderful Counselor. And faith in him is true wisdom. The New Testament, Paul and James speak about devilish wisdom. Wisdom which is from beneath, wisdom which belongs to the earth, and wisdom which looks all right, but eventually leads to disaster. But this wisdom from the Lord, who is wonderful in counsel and excellent in wisdom, this is the way to live our lives. As I read the chapter this week, as I prepared for this evening, I realized just how powerful it was speaking into our situation. And the words of the hymn that we're going to sing in a moment kept on echoing my ears. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. That is so much my experience day after day. And I'd be very surprised if it wasn't your experience as well. And when we do that, we need to remember that the Lord of hosts is wonderful in counsel and excellent in wisdom. James says, whoever lacks wisdom, let them ask of the Lord who gives generously and does not hold back. Let's be people who ask of the Lord for wisdom and so experience his generous giving. Amen. Let's pray. Lord God, those words shine so powerfully into the dark places of our hearts. We realize how we try so hard and to work out things by our own wisdom and do not rely on you and do not seek your help. And so give to us the grace, give to us the grace and the humility that will come to you in believing faith, so that we may indeed show the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Amen. So let's sing the words on the screen. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing your praise. Thank you. All the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. And until that day, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.